Alrighty, welcome to a standard video here on ChannelFireball.com, playing on Magic Online today. I'm going to be testing Drake's Arclight Phoenix. This deck is a standard deck that kind of fell out of favor, but I'm trying it again. This is actually the day before I leave for the Pro Tour, Mythic Championship, and I'm going to be testing this version out to see if I want to play it. So this is an insight into our Pro Tour / Mythic Championship testing. We've got two Terramanders as the new card, plus one Mass Manipulation. So not a whole lot of new cards, but I do think this deck's pretty powerful. What this deck is trying to do is get Arclight Phoenix into your graveyard using a Tormenting Voice, Discovery Dispersal, Chart a Course, and a Radical Idea, made cheaper by Electromancer, and string three spells together in the same turn to ideally put a couple Phoenixes into play. It's also got four copies of Crackling Drake, because it's just a really powerful card. Four mana, 6/4 draw card is really good. And then two Terramanders with a deck so full of spells, 25 spells in it, there's a pretty good chance you can flip this for just a couple of mana. Got a couple spice slots, one Beacon Bolt as a way to kill something and then kill another thing, and then an Entrancing Melody, because I think Entrancing Melody is fairly good right now. I kind of wanted a second in the sideboard, but I'm trying a spread of cards instead. Speaking of the sideboard, before we get there, the one Blood Crypt is so you can cast Discovery if you're on Mountains plus Blood Crypt, or just also sometimes cast Dispersal. Sideboard has five counterspells, three Negate, one Stainful Stroke, one Spell Pierce, which go in against decks like Nexus or Control decks. It's got two Sheevan Fires against the small aggro decks, Mass Manipulation against midrange. And then you have Ral and Niv-Mizzet plus Treasure Map and Search for Vizcanta to kind of make this deck into a grindier deck, can play an attrition game alongside Chemist's Insight, and then it has Sorcerer's Spyglass against the Teferi decks. So, let's hop into a standard league and get some Drakes going. Alrighty, welcome to round one. I'm gonna keep this hand. It's borderline for sure, but this deck has a lot of card flow, so when you have a Radical Idea in your opening hand, I'm gonna get to see a bunch of new cards before I end up having to make 20 plays. Looks like I'm playing against Nexus, likely Simic Nexus here. Memorial of Genius is pretty standard there. So let's just play Sulphur Falls and pass. Game one against Nexus is not very good. Your clock is not fast enough, and they have, they missed a land drop there because they Growth Spiraled in their Simic Guildgate but didn't have an actual land. Your clock just isn't fast enough and you don't have disruption. So for those reasons, you're not gonna beat Nexus game one all that often. You've got a bunch of dead removal. Ooh, if they're stuck on lands though, I have a shot. Let's opt, let's land on the bottom. There's a Phoenix, but I think I'd rather just play Crackling Drake here. I want to set up Phoenix so that I can Sinister Sabotage. Okay, did not expect that. Bidding a Hydroid Crisis. Okay. And they didn't hit their land. All right, let's play another Crackling Drake. I guess I should probably pay the correct mana for that. I'll kind of want to save Phoenix / Radical Idea for when I have enough spells to bring the Phoenix back. Like, I don't actually think I'm going to opt here, since I really want to do this next turn. All right, so now they're going to play Wilderness Reclamation. They're going to untap all their lands, and now I'm probably going to lose. I needed them to miss, like, a lot of land drops, because now I'm, like, I'm gonna get a bunch of Phoenixes into play, but I'm just not going to kill them fast enough. Well, I might not even get a bunch of Phoenixes. I might get one Phoenix into play. Opting a bunch of cards to the bottom. Charting a course, discard Arclight Phoenix. And then I could Radical Idea. I guess I will, even though I'm not all that likely to hit anything that does anything. All right. Land and send for 10 here. Opponent still has quite enough time to go Chemist's Insight end of turn. Oh, they did not have Chemist's Insight. So they're almost assuredly going to get to play a Nexus here. And because, like, there's no way they could have, basically they can't have a hand that has no lands and no Chemist's Insight and not have at least one or two copies of Nexus of Fate. And we'll find out. They do need an engine. Without Insight or Search for Vizcanta, then the deck does not gain a whole lot of benefit by taking a bunch of extra turns. Like, they're not actually pulling ahead here. Okay, they're hitting land drops now, but it's not clear to me what they're doing. I guess they can sack Memorial of Genius now. So they're going to untap. Let's see. They're going to cast another Nexus. Sure. Again, I mean, this is the sort of thing that kind of gets them somewhere. Now they're going to play a Hydroid Crisis. Let's see if they can hit the third Nexus here. Okay, they did not. So now there's actually a pretty good chance that they can fog me to death. Let's go... I guess let's play Crackling Drake first. Kind of doesn't matter which order I sequence it, because I'm not going to be able to discard or get this Phoenix back. So let's just Lava Coil the Hydroid Crisis. Ooh, I actually do have Discovery Dispersal here, so... If for some reason they don't have a fog this turn, which they're going to, if I wasn't able to kill them here and they don't go off on this next turn, then I might, like, they're going to cast a big Hydroid Crisis here, and then I think that's got to be enough to kill me here, because they're drawing three more cards. They didn't play a land. Okay. Basically, I might be in a spot where I can Discovery Dispersal their Wilderness Reclamation. Interesting. All right, so let's go Chart a Course. I'm going to get another Phoenix into play here. I want to make sure I can cast the Discovery Dispersal. Ditch a Beacon. Oh, I'm not supposed to ditch Beacon Bolt. Well, I guess I can just flashback the Beacon Bolt. It's for 9, yeah. All right, and then Beacon Bolt, their Hydra. Oh, Blink of an Eye, their Hydra. Okay. I think I might be able to get them here. So they're gonna fog here, and I'm gonna stop on their second main phase, where they're gonna tap out for, if they don't have a second Wilderness Reclamation, which they might at this point, in which case I could be in trouble. But if they don't have a second one, if they just play a big Hydroid Crisis, I can bounce their Wilderness Reclamation, and then they don't untap all their lands. Oh yeah. All right. And then, so we get to play this, and then they have to bounce their Wilderness Reclamation. So now they don't actually have an untap here, and they can block a Crackling Drake, and they actually die. Ha! Blood Crypt 1, opponent 0. I like Niv-Mizzet against them, and Entrancing Melody's crap. Sorcerer's Spyglass actually can do something, then you board in all the counterspells, of course. Part of it is, like, you have more dead cards to take out than anything. Like Shocks are terrible, Lava Coils are terrible. The Beacon Bolt's okay because it can kill the Hydroid Crisis. The question is it better than anything else I have here? I don't think Hydroid Crisis being in play is actually going to do all that much. And the question is, do I want Search for Ezcanta? Spyglass is basically the name, well, Ezcanta the Sunken Ruin or Memorial to Genius, which is not super powerful, but I think is worth bringing in. I guess I'll just take out the Chemist's Insight. I don't really have time for all that nonsense. And I will keep this hand. I mean, this hand is a little slow. I really want to have like an Electromancer in my opening hand, but I think with this many Ops and a Tormenting Voice, I think it's worth keeping rather than mulliganing. Okay, they didn't have a Growth Spiral yet. Blood Crypt, despite your fantastic work last game, I'm going to bin you, and then now I'm going to go Tormenting Voice, discarding Phoenix. Ooh, I was wondering if they had a Spell Piercer Negate, because those are certainly cards they could side in here. Okay, there's an Electromancer. No spells yet, though. There's another Phoenix. Let's start with Opt. Really looking for... Okay, Radical Idea is good. So now let's go land Electromancer. And next turn, my plan is to Radical Idea, then Radical Idea discarding Phoenix, and hopefully find another spell. I mean, they're going off kind of fast here, too. All right, let's go Radical Idea. Spell. All right, now I'm in trouble, because now... Not only was there a good chance that they could go off here anyways, because they do have the insight now, I have no disruption and really no clock. Okay, there goes Search for Ezcanta. Unclear whether I get another turn here. Doesn't look like I'm going to. There goes a Nexus. And they get to search, bidding a Root Snare. They have another Wilderness Reclamation. Oh no, they have another Chemist's Insight. They can still take an extra turn here if they find Nexus. And the thing is, even if they don't take an extra turn, I'm not doing all that much. Okay, they had another Chemist's Insight here. Yeah, now I have the Radical Idea of discarding Phoenix and just hope to hit Tormenting Voice or Chart a Course or something. All right, well, that's not going to do it. The problem is... When I do that and then don't play the Phoenix, it becomes pretty clear to my opponent that I just don't have anything. Oh wow, yeah, they're going off pretty hard here. I think it's going to be hard to win this game, even if somehow their hand isn't good right now. They're with Reclamation and Ezcanta and Memorial to Genius. They're going to get to look at so many cards here. Yeah, here comes the Hydroid Crisis. And my hand is four land and a Niv-Mizzet. Has not developed quite the way I would have hoped. Okay, there's a Charter Course. I guess that's a start. I think just playing Niv-Mizzet is not going to do the trick here. Okay, there's a Discovery Dispersal. So I get to get back the Phoenixes at least. Oh man, more lands. I need to find a counterspell or two. Opt. Land on the bottom. Draw another land. I have not... I've been turning through my deck all right, but not really finding a whole lot. And then... Wow. Okay. So... I cast a bunch of card draw spells, and I still, at the end of all of it, my hand ended up being Niv-Mizzet, a Drake in all lands. Let's just send... If they want to kill an Electromancer and take 8, that's fine with me. Nexus. All right, whatever. I'm just dead here. Like, I'm super, super dead. Yeah, I mean, I don't want a sorcery speed card like Ral. Yeah, I don't think I want Beacon Bolt. It feels like I can do better than that. All right, let's go to game three here. All right, I would like to play first. This hand is not acceptable. It's very close to being good. Double Phoenix Charter Course is awesome, but I just, too often with that hand, I'm just going to go Island Go. Keep, put an Island on the bottom. Just play a tap Steam Vents. I'm not spell piercing their opt on turn one, or they're nothing. And now I'm going to play Electromancer on two. And now I have more outs to find a Phoenix here. Okay, they get their search out. That's fine. All right, looking for Arclight Phoenix. I have to keep Negate. Negate is good enough. And another opt. Okay, there's an Arclight Phoenix. Then play a land. Actually, I guess I should have played a... played my island first so I could Tormenting Voice. Though I think I do actually want to wait on Tormenting Voice a little, because with Electromancer out, I'm not gated on mana, I'm gated on actual cards. So I'd rather be able to Tormenting Voice now, discard Phoenix, and hopefully string together enough spells this turn. Ooh, they might actually help given the fact that I get to play a counterspell now. They're enabling my Phoenix via via counterspell. All right. So I've played three now, so now I don't have to play this Radical Idea. And now this is the kind of game I want to play. I can smash for five here. If they play a Wilderness Reclamation, I get to counter it. Ooh, a funny interaction there. They just put Nexus of Fate in their graveyard, but it doesn't actually help flip search. It's funny because it gets shuffled back in. All right, now I get to look for some cards. I really just want to find another counterspell. So I'm going to do some digging here. And I'm going to Radical Idea... I actually think it's the blood... Oh, man, this is actually kind of close. Well, hold on. Right now, I have enough spells to easily flip Terramander. I haven't played a land yet. I think it's just going to be discarding Blood Crypt at this point and just hoping to hit. And then let's Radical Idea discarding Electromancer. Okay, didn't hit a spell there, so now I'm going to attack. But this puts my opponent to dead next turn to my Terramander. And I still have... No, I'm out of Radical Ideas. But Terramander has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so it costs 2 to flip it. So now they're in a spot where they need to have a Root Snare right away. Because the best thing they can do is go Wilderness Reclamation and untap all my lands and then have Root Snare. Oh, not they're at 9? Okay, so that does keep them alive. But let's see what this chart, of course, finds. Chart into... Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so I can level up the Terramander, and I can just see what I draw here. So let's play a land. They're at 9. They actually have outs now, unfortunately, because they get to go to 2 here, or I guess get to go to 4 here. So I level up, and now because they wouldn't be able to flip this Conta, by the way, had Nexus and been any other card. But now they actually have enough mana that if they have land, Wilderness Reclamation, they can Nexus me. Okay, they have the Reclamation, so they have to have a Root Snare here, and I have to not draw a counterspell. I guess they can Root Snare upkeep. Well, did not hit here. Let's send and see what happens. And if they have it, they have it. They do. Okay. This is going to be close. I'm not going to play Electromancer. I don't think it matters too much. So I think I'm going to need... I think I basically needed to hit another counterspell here. There's a chance that they can't go off this turn, but it's pretty low. Basically, once they've gotten insight into the bin, plus flipped as Kanta, plus have the reclamation, it's going to be pretty hard. Oh yeah, the second reclamation almost assuredly does the trick. So it was close. I needed them not to have... Basically, they needed not to have a second Wilderness Reclamation. I mean, they now have a third, but it's going to... I assume I'm dead here. I needed to draw one of my... one more counter. Though I only have five counter spells, so it's not like this deck is flooded with counters. Okay. Let's see. So they got Sinister Sabotage. That doesn't do it. I mean, they technically could miss here. I just... Having played the blue-green deck a lot, it's pretty unlikely that they do. Okay, Chemist's Insight's not an Nexus. They also may not have all four Root Snares in their deck at this point. Yep, and they lost. Okay, we got pretty lucky there, but I will take it. And next turn, we were not getting there in a counterspell. Alrighty. Well, that was round one. Whew, exciting. Let's head to round two. Alrighty, welcome to round two. I would, in fact, like to play first. And yes, this hand's keepable. Double Phoenix with two cantrips is a good hand. Basically, what I'm looking for out of this hand is Tormenting Voice or Electromancer, some combo of those cards. But we'll see what we're playing against, too, because if we're playing against, like, White Weenie, we might want to find Shock. Playing against Sultai here. Do not want Shock against Sultai. Ooh, Radical Idea helps. Electromancer would be nice, too, but Radical Idea is very good because that's a discard outlet for one Phoenix, so what we're going to do end of turn is just play a Radical Idea. Oh, never mind. Mid-range black or... Also, where did my pictures go? Well, let's go ahead and Radical Idea in response here. And now they can take an Opt or a Radical Idea, and I'm not particularly worried about which one they take. More if all the... was most likely Sultai, because Sultai is more popular than this mid-range black-red deck, but certainly we are proven wrong. All right, they took Opt, which makes sense. And now I wish I had that Shock. Ooh, Electromancer is nice. So... I think we're gonna pay the life and play an Electromancer, and then we have Radical Idea up, even though I think it's pretty likely my opponent kills the Electromancer. The other thing against a deck like this mid-range deck that's not going super fast, I can just start casting these Phoenixes and they can't just ignore them. Alright, let's take our one. And this also forces them to spend mana killing the Electromancer, which maybe that's not what they wanted to do with their turn. Or they just play a Rick's Mighty Reveler. That works for me. Discarding their Siege Gang. And do they have the Shock? Ooh, they might not. It's Radical Idea here. Into Opt. Okay, so draw. Oh yeah, now we have it all. So let's go Chart a Course. Discard Phoenix. Chart a Course. Discard Phoenix. And then I'm going to Opt in case I try to find one more Phoenix, I think. All right, and bottom. And didn't get there on the Phoenix, but that's okay. Land, let's get these two back and send with both. I don't really want to trade Electromancer for Rick's Mighty Reveler. That does not sound good. And then I'm going to play a Terramander because it's going to be a 5-5 next turn for only two mana. There's not a ton they can do to easily get out of this. Okay, they can Lava Coil a Phoenix. They have two Lava Coils and cast down the Terramander. All right, I guess that's a start, and then they can hit me for one. But I still actually get to see a lot of new cards here too. Ooh, Tormenting Voice. So let's go Tormenting... Actually, let's go Radical Idea discarding Island first in case I find... I was going to see if I found a Crackling Drake, I would have been happy to play that. All right, Tormenting Voice, discard a land. And now I'm going to play one more Radical Idea. Because at this point, I can just cast Phoenix if I hit it. So no reason not to just draw more cards. And I think I'm just going to Lava Coil the Rick's Mighty Reveler and attack for 5 here. I can get back my my Opt later. I would rather just get extra damage in. Because this puts my opponent on a 3-turn clock with just the one Phoenix. Oh, well, a little punished there, but I'm sure I can find more action here. Let's go Tormenting Voice, discard a Mountain, chart a Course, discard... Mountain, and then I think I just play a Crackling Drake here because it's pretty mana efficient, draws me another card, and then I just pass. I'm not going to trade it for Rekindling Phoenix, obviously, but my opponent's not really in a position where they can attack me all that well. Okay, they're going to choop my Crackling Drake and probably just say go. I mean, I guess they could attack with Rekindling Phoenix, but it doesn't seem that that's very profitable. I'm just going to be able to find another Lava Coil here, or at least it's fairly likely. I have got a... maybe not as likely as I thought. Let's see how many cards I can see here. Oh, there's the Lava Coil. So let's kill the Rekindling Phoenix and send it with the Arclight Phoenix. I don't think trading Electromancer for Chupacabra is very good, especially when they have Memorial out. Not that they're very close to being able to use Memorial, but another thing is you also want to keep a land in hand a lot of the time for your charts and Tormenting Voices. Like in this particular case, I don't have any Tormenting Voices left in my deck, but there it is. But I still think I'd rather just keep a land in hand here. Angrath the Flame Chained. Okay, discard my island, sure. Another Phoenix would be a good draw here. Oh, Beacon Bolt's pretty nice. So it's Beacon Bolt. Wow, this actually lets me kill my opponent. Yeah, let's just Beacon Bolt the Freebooter. Then I can cast. I don't even need to cast Opt. I can just Beacon Bolt the Chupacabra, discarding the Opt, and then attack my opponent for 7. Nice. All right, Red-Black Midrange, I think, is a deck that I'm happy to play against. I like Ral sounds good against them, as does Treasure Map. Basically, I think we board as if we're going to play a kind of grindy game. Niv-Mizzet's bad against Chupacabra, but it's good against just removal in general. This is where I wish I had a Fiery Cannonade to stop Siege Gang Commander. I like Disdainful Stroke, though, because that actually counters a lot of their stuff. Like, Shocks seem pretty bad against them. Keep the Lava Coils. My inclination is to keep Beacon Bolt, because it's double removal. Maybe some of this stuff is too slow. Entrancing Melody doesn't sound great. I do like the Lava Coils for the Phoenix, of course. Maybe I don't actually want Niv-Mizzet. I think that might actually just be a little bit too slow. Alrighty, time for round two. Playing us Red Black Midrange, and we're gonna be mulliganing this hand. 6-land Arclight Phoenix, too much even for me. Even as deranged as I am. We'll keep this hand. This hand's good. It's got Electromancer and some cantrips and a Crackling Drake, so good place to start. In general, you really want to play your cantrips post Electromancer. I mean, that's obvious, right? It makes them cheaper. But for that reason, it's often worth risking just playing an Electromancer on 2 and hoping you untap with it. Another cool thing about this deck, by the way, is that your opponent's gonna be incentivized to leave in cards like Shock to kill your Electromancer. But when you don't draw Electromancer, Shock is really just not that impressive. Like, here, I'm putting my opponent to the test. Do they have a way to kill Electromancer? Because if they don't, I'm going to get a Phoenix into play. Okay, they do. Cast Down, unfortunately, is just good. Because Cast Down does kill Crackling Drake as well. Let's go chart a course. I want to see more cards. And discard a Phoenix and then play a land. And here, I don't think I really want to cast Opt end of turn. Because without an Electromancer, Opt is the best way to string 3 cards together. So I'm gonna wait on, or 3 spells, right, for Phoenix. I'm gonna wait on that. My opponent's probably gonna take the Opt, actually. But I'm also fine with them taking Opt and just keeping that there. And then on my turn, I'm just gonna play a Crackling Drake, and this sets up for potentially a turn 5 Phoenix if I can find something. I wonder if I do want Shock, actually. Killing Freebooter's kinda nice. I don't really care about killing Rick's Mighty Reveler very much. All right, that's fine. We'll take 3. We've got another one coming. And actually wouldn't mind hitting a land here. Treasure Map may be a little slow. Chemist's Insight, okay. Let's see if they have a way to kill this Crackling Drake. They don't yet. That's good. That can kind of keep their squadron back. And now, ooh, Lava Coil. Well, I'm definitely going to do Lava Coil here. The question is, what else am I going to do? I think I'm going to go Lava Coil you and then attack with the Crackling Drake and then cast a Chart a Course to draw. To just straight up draw a bunch of cards. And then chart a course and land and then pass. Now I can decide whether I want to opt because I have the option to play 3 spells a lot of the time here. Dire Fleet, Daredevil. Oh, they're going to get my Lava Coil. Well, I'm glad I attacked then. Okay, so we're taking a bit of damage here. All right. I think I'm actually coming around on just wanting Shock in my deck because it's a cheap spell and take out like this Treasure Map. Like it might actually be a fast enough matchup. I'm actually going to opt here. I'm going to put land on the bottom. I can find a land, I think. So now I can Phoenix. I think my goal is to cast to get a Phoenix into play here. And I think the way I'm going to do that is to find to see as many cards as possible, because I really need to see a second Phoenix. All right, chart a course helps. Did not get there. Discard a land, and I guess we're going to Discovery Dispersal to see if we can hit two more Phoenixes. I'm going to put these both in my graveyard and then get Phoenix back and pass. And now we're in a bit of trouble. We're not literally dead if they kill our Phoenix, but we're pretty close. And oh, they should attack with the Freebooter also. I guess I'll block the Rixmoddy Reveler. I'm really happy trading off Phoenix, though. That puts me in a pretty good spot. If they don't have a follow-up play here, then we could be doing all right. Even if they have a Rekindling Phoenix, that's not so bad because we have this Lava Coil. Okay, so now what's really going to come down to is, can we find another Phoenix? So we have 6 mana, 7 potentially, which means let's kick things off with Radical Idea. Phoenix, no. And now we're going to go Tormenting Voice, discard Steam Vents. Unfortunately, we're not going to get to play a Phoenix, but they didn't have much of a play last turn. And then now we're going to keep playing lands because we've got a land-heavy hand here. And now if they attack with just their Direfleet Daredevil, I think I'll send in with all. Okay, well, I'm just going to be priced into blocking there. Going to one. And if they don't have a play... Oh no, another Phoenix, okay. Things are getting dicey, but actually we're not out of it yet. Ooh, that really helps. All right, so let's go chart a course, discard Arclight Phoenix. So basically I need to find another removal spell. My last Lava Coil. Bottom, or another Phoenix. Opt. I guess that's actually fine. If I had more mana, I would have had the opportunity to cast Dispersal. So we're looking for Phoenix or Lava Coil here. Oh man, Beacon Bolt is slightly too slow. Oh, Terramander, okay. Because now I have 2 Phoenixes and a Terramander. All right, I guess that'll do it. I mean, that'll do it as in we're not dead this turn, but it doesn't mean that we're gonna win. I like how my 2 sideboard cards have been the worst cards this entire game, just the treasure map plus Chemist's Insight. I think my opponent's in trouble if they can't kill me this turn, though. I mean, they obviously have a lot of outs because they get to draw an extra card with Arch, and they have cards like Siege Gang Commander or Carnival Carnage in their deck. But if they don't have anything, right, if their hand is, let's say, just 2 lands, then their attacks here just aren't good. Terramander blocks Rekindling Phoenix, Phoenix eats Kitesail, and then I chump Direfleet Daredevil. And... All right, actually, Terramander blocks Direfleet Daredevil, and these 2 block. So they end up losing all their creatures, and I lose 1 Phoenix. That does not seem great for them. Okay, well, Siege Gang's going to make it hard, though. That, on the other hand... Oh, I should have leveled up the Terramander in turn. I was too busy talking. Yeah, I don't see how we're getting out of that. Like, we can Tormenting Voice here, discard Treasure Map, because we're never going to use it. Electromancer was something I needed earlier, so let's see. They have 3, 6 creatures. Yeah, I just can't even get to enough creatures or enough damage here. I guess I could have cast a Electromancer. I would have not seen enough cards here. All right, so I'm going to do an About Face here. Get Treasure Map and Chemist's Insight out. Get Shocks in. I think Shock is better than Shivanfire. Shivanfire can kill Rekindling Phoenix, but Shock can hit Planeswalkers, which I kind of like. So let's take out those. The question is, do I want and then take out a search for another Shock? Yeah. Actually, this deck's game, my main game plan seems good enough that I think I just need to not slow myself down too much, which is kind of what I did last game. Okay, this hand's good. This hand is quite good. I mean, it's a little speculative in that I've got a 5-drop that is a little far away from being cast, but I still get to play turn 2 Electromancer, which really puts the pressure on them to kill it. And then I've got 1 cantrip that I can start playing with Electromancer. Radical Idea is the best with Electromancer, by the way. That's the best of all the cantrips because you cast it twice, whereas Chart of Course and Tormenting Voice, you only cast it once. So there's a lot more savings. All right, they're going to kill that. Land would be really nice here. Land. Let's just chart a course then, because I really want to hit land drops. Okay. Well, I don't think we're out of it here. And maybe I should have discarded Radical Idea, but it feels like I'm going to be cycling through those kind of nicely. Oh. Okay, they're just going to eat my Beacon Bolt. I think that's not a very good use of Darkfleet Daredevil, actually. Let's Radical Idea. Okay, well, this is a way to lose this for sure. I think this matchup's pretty good, even though I misboarded horribly to lose game two. But, all right, if I draw a mountain here, a red source, I think I'm in still good shape. All right, let's just Lava Coil the Phoenix and continue on. Because if I was able to go Electromancer Lava Coil, I actually would have liked my spot. Now they're just going to play a Siege Gang, and yeah, then I can't win. But imagine had I hit land drops and could have just played a bunch of stuff instead. That would have been better than not doing anything. That's my assumption, at least. All right, let's opt. All right, there's my land. Land, and I guess Lava Coil the Siege Gang is my best bet here. And we'll see what they've got. Angrath, all right. Yeah, we're done here. I don't think I'm coming back from this. Ugh, well, that's frustrating. I did lose game two due to misboarding. Had those two cards been shocks, I think I would have won game two. So that is on me. But game three, keeping the hand with all cantrips, you know, two land and a couple cantrips, or two land a cantrip and two Electromancers, and just basically never playing a third land. This kind of sucks. All right. Welcome to round three. This hand is good despite having two tapped Sulphur Falls, just because Sulphur Falls into Sulphur Falls plus Opt can kind of get us going. Playing against White Weenie, huh? Well, that's not the hand where you want all tap lands, but they didn't play anything on turn one. They might not be White Weenie. We'll see. Okay, never mind. They were just playing a Plains turn one. Wait, I kind of don't get what's going on here. I'm actually going to play a Terramander here because Chart a Course without discarding can be nice on turn three. Let's see what they've got. Oh, they are playing White Weenie. What hand did they keep without one or two drops? I don't really get it, but I'm going to attack. And let's see. I think I'm going to Chart a Course. I'll let them untap with their Banalish Marshal, I guess. And then play Steam Vents and then pay the life and then pass. I can either opt here or cast Shock, depending on what they do. And the thing is, that their turn 3 Banalish Marshal is also worse than a History of Benalia, so... Okay, that's fine. I really don't get what... I'm trying to, like, deconstruct my opponent's hand. What do they keep? 5 land, 2 Banalish Marshals? Or are they not playing a land this turn? And they are playing a land. Okay. I don't really get it, but I'm going to opt. Probably priced into keeping lands. I do not want to opt, though. So now I'm definitely going to Lava Coil one of those Banalish Marshals. The question is, what else am I going to do? I think it's probably just cast Chart a Course. I guess I'm not playing around main deck Spell Pierce. That's nonsense. Because I think it's a little better to attack, chart, and then Lava Coil here. Because if I draw a land where I don't have to pay life, that's just a little bit better. Still paid the iron price there. All right, let's Lava Coil that thing. Pass. And then next turn I can Entrancing Melody their Banalish Marshal. I mean, I guess they could have had a Venerated Loxodon. That's a card they could have here. Tithe Taker, that card's not bad. And then now they're going to play their Loxodon. And I'm at 12. All right. Ooh, Electromancer would have been nicer earlier, but still might be pretty good here. So I go to 10 if I think I'm just going to pay the price here and Entrancing Melody their Banalish Marshal. And then I think I just pass in case they have Unbreakable Formation. I don't really want to chump with Terramander. Like, if they just attack for 7, I guess even Unbreakable Formation doesn't force me to chump. But I'm just going to keep this back because I don't think 1 point matters, and there are some combinations they could have that might make me want to block. Let's see. Conclave Tribunal. Okay. That's fine. And then I'll just take 7 here, go to 3. But then next turn, if they don't have another play here, and they kept a really slow hand, they should not have. Whatever hand my opponent kept was not a keepable hand. Look, I'm a scientist when it comes to keepable hands, because I keep a lot of really bad ones. That was not a keepable hand. What am I doing here? I have 5 cards in the graveyard. I could go like Electromancer, Tormenting Voice, discarding Shock. And then I'll have 7 in the bin, so I go Electromancer, Tormenting Voice, Terramander, then I can level up both Terramanders. That actually sounds pretty nice. Discard Shock, play a Terramander, and then just pass here. Oh, actually, I should I should level these up now because of the type taker. Alright, level these up, pass. And then with double Crackling Drake in the mix, I can get some good blocks. I'm not going to attack because I don't want to die to a Conclave Tribunal. And I might want to get some spicy double blocks going. Alright, there goes History of Benalia. I can live with that. Let's go Crackling Drake. Pay reds. Draw. Then play an Electromancer and I think a Radical Idea. Because I'm already not going to... Yeah, and I couldn't have waited. So now I'm going to hit with one of the Terramanders. Actually, I just have Lethal next turn, so let's just wait. And I guess if they have a Conclave Tribunal to kill the Crackling Drake, I don't have Lethal anymore. But I wouldn't have had Lethal with just the two Terramanders anyway, so I think just waiting is probably smarter here. And now I can just kill my opponent. I guess I could do some ops and stuff to try to find an Arclight Phoenix, though it doesn't change a whole lot. In fact, I guess we'll Beacon Bolt a Loxodon. And sure, let's just attack with my Flyers. I mean, I don't see how they get out of this with the normal set of cards from this deck. So my opponent kept Conclave Tribunal, Venerated Loxodon, two Banalish Marshals, three lands, something like that? Yeah, you just can't do that. All right, let's put in some Sheevan Fires. Kind of call it a day. Like, this deck's not actually looking to side a whole lot more than that. And then probably just take out two Radical Ideas because those are the slower cantrips. And the Phoenix plan is less good against this deck. You're just looking to kill all their stuff early and then play some Drakes or what have you. And yeah, that should do it. Alrighty, time for game two, and while my opponent's deciding whether they should mulligan this time, I would like to tell you about ChannelFireball.com. Of course, that is who is bringing you this video. Channel Fireball is a great place for buying or selling of cards, sealed product. It's also the place to find the best free magic strategy on the web. So check out ChannelFireball.com, check out our YouTube page, you know, scope us out, and supporting Channel Fireball gets you more of these videos where I can get mana screwed and complain about it. Thanks for watching, and let's just get into our next round here, as soon as my opponent decides whether or not they're keeping their hand. Alrighty, my opponent mulliganed to six. I'm going to keep this hand. It doesn't have a shock. Like, that is the best predictor victory against White Weenie, is having a shock in your opener, followed by Electromancer, and so it's actually short both those things. But it does have double Lava Coil here, and I think that's worth it. I'm going to pay the life. I think it's worth paying two life to play this opt, because if I find something a turn sooner, that might yield a dividend of higher than two life. All right, they're going to hit me for one. Also, they played Healer's Hawk turn one, which is the worst of the one drops against Drakes. Sure. They can Dauntless Bodyguard their Healer's Hawk if they want. And so they probably drew the Bodyguard this turn. Let's opt to another opt. I don't think I want that. I would rather just find a shock or something like that. All right, Lava Coil. I guess I'm going to Lava Coil the Dauntless Bodyguard just so I don't get too far behind here. With double Lava Coil in hand, it seems better. Also, it stops them from casting a Venerated Loxodon on this turn. All right, Leiden's Landing, huh? And then next turn, I'm ideally casting like a Charter Course or something. I think I'm just going to play a tapped Steam Vents and pass. Yeah, because if they play a Venerated Loxodon, so first of all, they have to draw the land and have to have the Loxodon. But I think it's relatively likely they have one of those things. Or, well, rather, that they have the Loxodon. They clearly don't have the land. Even then, I can Lava Coil the Loxodon, and I think I'd rather not spew here. Let's just play Crackling Drake. And if they have a Conclave Tribunal, that's fine. Then next turn, I'm just going to start hard casting Arclight Phoenixes. Also, this Terramander is kind of getting in there. Okay, here comes the Elephant. The Elefante. That is fine. Let's just play Arclight Phoenix and Terramander here. And if my opponent does have Conclave Tribunal for Crackling Drake, I can still block one of their smaller things with Arclight Phoenix. Their Elephant maybe gets in, but this is so much more mana efficient that next turn I can hard cast another Arclight Phoenix and play a Lava Coil. And that would, I think, work out pretty well for me. Also, if they attack with just the Elephant, I can just double block if I want with Phoenix plus Drake. Though I probably won't even do that. They have four cards in hand. None of them are lands. What happens if they attack with everything? Or Crackling Drake eats Dauntless Bodyguard, Arclight Phoenix blocks Vampire Token. I take two, they flip their, or I take six rather, they flip their Legion's Landing, and I trade Arclight Phoenix for two of their creatures. Yeah, that sounds fine to me. Block, block. And then next turn, I can Lava Coil the Venerated Loxodon. And it depends if I draw, or maybe I'll Lava Coil. Yeah, it'll still be Venerated Loxodon. And if I draw another spell, maybe I could try to get this other Phoenix, get the Phoenix back. But we're not there. So let's just go kill Loxodon, play a land, play Arclight Phoenix, and then unfortunately drew a land this turn. This actually does put me in a somewhat dangerous spot. I'm just going to attack for one here because now I'm actually kind of flooding out where every turn I've had good things to do, this next turn at my best play might just be level up Terramander. I also only attacked with Terramander in case they had Conclave Tribunal. I'm just worried that if I attacked with both the Phoenix and the Terramander, the Tribunal the Drake hit me for 4 down to 4, then I'm in a pretty big hole. Whereas now if they have Tribunal for Drake, it's still good, but I get to trade off Phoenix. Also, if they had a Conclave Tribunal, I think they would have cast it last turn, but who knows. All right, another History of Benalia. Yeah, we're going to have to settle in because these histories are going to get in there. So let's just play a land and pass. So these Knight tokens, I'm going to block one with Arclight Phoenix and one with Terramander. And I don't really want to draw or block one with Crackling Drake here. So what we need to draw is like basically Tormenting Voice, Radical Idea, you know, Chart a Course. I need something like that. Because where I'm at currently, I'm just so far behind that I'm going to need to play multiple cards in the next turn. Also, if I draw one of those, I might be able to get my Phoenix back, which would be a nice little benefit here. Especially since my opponent's catching up to me on spells. First of all, they've only drawn three land, and that helps. And then also their History of Benalias kind of function as multiple cards in the same card, because that's a really powerful card. So I'm going to end up in a spot where I don't think I have I can't keep up one for one. Lava Coil is not good against this sort of thing. I really hope they attack with that Healer's Hawk, by the way. Yes, because I wasn't blocking the Knight with a Crackling Drake anyway. They actually really should not attack with that Healer's Hawk. It gives me a free bird. And let's just go ahead and do that, that. And this is very easy blocks. Level up the Terramander. And, I mean, trading a Phoenix for two Knights and a Healer's Hawk is a great deal for me. All right, Odonto Vanguard into a Tithe Taker. Yep, into a Conclave Tribunal? Why didn't they do that first? Wow, they could have really gotten me there. Well, I'm pretty dead now. Shock does not do the trick. I can shock one thing and then die badly. All right, I would like to concede this game. And that does not make me really want to change how I board. I mean, yes, in a game where I'm that flooded, mass manipulation or something would be good, but that's just not the standard game. Alrighty, welcome to game three. I would, in fact, like to play first, and yeah, this hand is good. This is almost a perfect hand against a white weenie. I mean, sure, I'd rather have a Chart a Course given that I have a turn one Terramander here, but still, being able to play turn one Terramander, and then we've got a pair of Shocks ready to roll against my opponent's first couple plays. And I think here I'm going to just cast Discovery Dispersal. I guess I actually could have played the other land. But Island in my graveyard. I'll keep Lava Coil, I think. I think if I didn't have the Terramander, I would have been inclined to bin the Lava Coil. But because I have both Terramander and Entrancing Melody, I kind of like, oh, there you go. So we're going to want Entrancing Melody, the Odonto Vanguard. I actually like that you can Entrancing Melody Vampire Token. So if you're playing White Weenie against Drakes, you have a good incentive not to do that. Not to play Legion's Landing on turn one, but we're going to want to save it for the Odonto Vanguard, I think. And I think we're just going to shock the Vampire Token now because we want to prevent a Venerated Loxodon from coming out. Next turn is a bit of a sweat because if I don't draw a land, I might be getting kind of far behind. I do wish I'd kept the land on top for Discovery, but I didn't anticipate drawing another 4-drop. They just play a Benalish Marshal would have been nicer to see. Let's shock the token end of turn. All right, land. Land, I'll be pretty happy here. All right, land. And I think I like just going Entrancing Melody here, because that gets me closer to my Terramander leveling up. Oop. No, I was supposed to attack, not... Oh, I see. I can't... F8 doesn't work when you have a Dante Vanguard in play anymore. This gets me closer to Entrancing Melody, and it's a lot better against Conclave Tribunal. Or Venerated Loxon, for that matter. Basically, it makes their Convoke cards work to just be stealing something rather than playing a Crackling Drake. So now... If I draw a land, what I could do is go Lava Coil plus level up Terramander and attack for 8. Here, I don't really want to draw a land too much. I would rather just draw a good spell. Could also just play a Crackling Drake. I'm at 14, so I have a little bit of room for error here. I don't like... You know, Shock does not have a great matchup against History of Benalia, but it does work out... It does take a lot of the punch away, because you don't take 2 this turn, and I don't take 6 next turn. So even though they get an advantage overall in that exchange, I think that it's not as bad as it could be. Pulling it deep in the tank. And usually, when White Weenie has to make a tough decision, because the deck's not that tough to play, it's because of Convoke. Because Convoke really is what stretches like your mana, it you know really impacts your sequencing, and it really makes you think like, do I want to wait an extra turn to cast a 0 mana Venerated Loxodon with full value, giving 5 creatures plus and plus 1? Or do I want to just do the best I can do and just play the Loxodon this turn? So, you know, do you want to set up History of Benalia for next turn? That sort of thing. So I would imagine my opponent has some decision like that in their hand, because if your hand is just all 1 and 2 drops, you just can kind of cast them. Yeah, my opponent's going to play a Venerated Loxodon here, I believe. Oh, Banalish Marshall, okay. Well, that's good, because I can Lava Coil that. Ooh, and a Sheaving Fire. So let's go Lava Coil to Banalish Marshall. And then send with these two, since it's not like the Adonto Vanguard blocks all that well. And then I'm probably just going to Sheaving Fire the Knight token here, because that makes it so their History of Benalia doesn't do anything, and makes it... So my Terramander is getting pretty close to leveling. It can only cost 2 mana to level. And then also makes it so my opponent's Convoke cards are a lot less impressive. So the way that we've played this so far, they haven't had a good target for Conclave Tribunal. Like, yeah, they can kill my Terramander, but that's just not a very efficient play. So here comes the Loxodon. Now I think it's a pretty easy Crackling Drake. Just use it for my 4 mana here, and then... I'll send for 1 in the air because I'm not really planning on blocking. And now if their last card's a Conclave Tribunal, I still think I'm doing okay. It's not great. I guess I take 9. But I can put a Danto Vanguard in the way of Venerated Loxodon. And note that note that my Terramander is very close to leveling up here. So I guess I just take 9, because blocking with Vanguard is about the same either way. So let's just take it and draw. Ooh, and they drew another thing. Okay, Dauntless Vanguard can get blocked. So here, what I'm looking to draw, I suppose a cheap spell would be good. Because basically I want to make 2 relevant plays next turn, right? I want to, like, I'm not dead even if I just make 1, but making 2 would really put me far ahead, I think. So they're choosing what to bodyguard up here. And 1, 2, 3, they don't have the City's Blessing, but they're what, 1 short? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, yeah. Let's see here. All right, so we drew a mountain. So let's say if I just play... If I just play Crackling Drake here, and then if I draw a Shock, that's I get to play base, essentially do 2 things. I'm kind of counting Terramander as doing a thing. I could also opt, and if I draw Lava Coil, Shock, Sheaven Fire, then I get to kill something and level up Terramander. So basically, it's the... Because if I just play 1 thing, I'm still alive here. I block 3 things, I go to 3, so I'm still doing okay. I think it's better to opt here. The problem is opts, it ends up being very mana inefficient if I opt, and then... So this is going to be flying. I'll block. It's not great. Whereas if I play Crackling Drake, I can chump the Loxodon block there and go to 1, but not block with Terramander. It's pretty close here. It really depends on what they draw. I don't think there's an easy way for me to beat a Conclave Tribunal or Banalish Marshal off the top. I think Opt is a little bit more likely. I guess I can also Opt and then play Crackling Drake if it doesn't work out. So this has to be better. All right. Tormenting Voice. I think I'm going to put that on the bottom. Now I'm just going to play a Crackling Drake here and pass the turn. Yeah, Steam Vents isn't great, but I can just discard that to my Chart of Course. All right. We'll see how this all works out here. Assuming my opponent didn't draw a relevant card, they swing with everything. I put Odonto Vanguard and Venerated Loxodon, and I put Crackling Drake on Skymarcher Aspirant, and I go to 1. And then next turn, they have 4 creatures, essentially, against my 2 and I'm at 1. It's not spectacular. I could also put Crackling Drake on Venerated Loxodon, Vanguard on Dauntless Bodyguard. No, that doesn't sound very good either. So basically, I'm going to need to hit something next turn. The other thing is I'm actually close to killing my opponent. I mean, depending on what they do, but I have 12 power in the air. Oh, another Dauntless Bodyguard. So now they get to put that on the Sky Marcher, I suppose. It's going to be hard to kill them if they attack that Vampire Token, however. Oh, they put them both on Venerated Loxodon. Okay, I don't think that's what they wanted to do. All right, let's go Crackling Drake there. This block's there. And I think I just take 4, going to 1 here. I guess if I put that there, I'd go to 3. Maybe it was better to block. Because right now, they're going to end up with a lot of creatures to my very few creatures. I need to find some Arclight Phoenixes. All right, let's go Discovery. Yeah, actually, sure, just blocked with Terramander now that I think about it. All right, Graveyard, put on top. Chart of Course. Because I'm just going to be priced into blocking here anyway. Land. Or I could just hit Lethal off Shock. Oh, wow, that was very skilled. Shock you. Attack for 15 in the air. Well, not blocking with Terramander was great. We did it. There we go. We are now 2-1, and let's get to our last match here. Alrighty, welcome to round 4. We're 2-1. This hand is keepable but unexciting. It doesn't have Electromancer or Drake. Uh-oh. We're not winning this game. Monterey is a tough matchup for Drake, so I have not liked this matchup very much, and I think that if you expect a lot of mono red, Drakes is not the deck for you. Let's see what their turn 2 play is here. Probably light up the stage, if I had to guess. All right, light up the stage into Mountain Wizard's Lightning. Okay. Time for me to find some Phoenixes here. Oh, there's a Terramander. That's not the absolute worst. Let's go Discovery. I'm just going to put Steam Mints in the graveyard and Tormenting Voice in the graveyard. First of all, I don't think paying untapped Steam Vents is very strong. I guess I have all 2 drops, so I could just do that. Okay, Wizard Lightning me. That's actually not the worst for me. Oh, there's a Blood Crypt. Let's go Tormenting Voice, discard Radical Idea. Just play a tapped Steam Vents. I'm not paying 2 life to play a Terramander, I don't think, especially since Terramander is going to be leveled up somewhat soon here. Well, if my opponent's playing the red-black version, this is essentially mono red aggro, but you know, playing black for a couple black cards. Oh, it's just burn, straight up burn. Okay, this matchup's horrible. This is actually the more mid range they get, the better it gets for you. But this is horrendous. All right, let's shock that. Play a tapped Blood Crypt and play a Terramander, but there's just like no way I'm racing this. Whew. Take a bite out of crime here. All right, well, for me to win this match, I need to have a lot of All right, draw 3 cards, I guess. For me to win this match, I needed to have a lot of Phoenixes in my opening hand. Gitu Lavarar. And I think we just chump here. right? Because I'm just going to play a Crackling Drake next turn. If they don't play a land here, I'm super dead. Because them not playing a land means that they have all spells in their hand, I think. Oh, no, they already did play a land this turn. Well, in any case, I'm super dead. Play a Crackling Drake and pass. Get Wizard's Lightning to end of turn? Oh, shocked. Okay. And they can flash back that risk factor. All right, here comes Lightning Strike. And here comes Lightning Strike. Yep. Black Red Burn. I'm going to put two Sheevan Fires in and a Spell Pierce. And I guess negates... Not Search for Risconta. Take Beacon Bolt out, Entrancing Melody out, and Radical Ideas out. I think Radical Ideas is just too slow, and I think having a couple counters is going to be a little better. Alrighty, I would like to play first here, and yeah, I got to keep this hand. Double Shock and double Crackling Drake is not bad. The problem is they have, besides their like Lava Runners and Firebrands, they have just a lot of spells. So yes, I'm going to get to Shock a Firebrand, but there's a chance like the second Shock is not going to do much. I'm definitely shocking this now to prevent up light up the stage. Also, I could play Electromancer, but Electromancer in this hand doesn't do that much, and I can just play it next turn. Okay, there's an Arclight Phoenix. Now I actually do need to hit a land, because, you know, when you can prevent their creatures from doing any damage to you, and when they're lightning striking my Electromancer, which is great for me, maybe I can race them with Kraken Drakes or an Arclight Phoenix, especially if they're on two lands. All right, land. Not great, but maybe they burned the Electromancer. Oh, they didn't have a play end of turn, and then they drew a land. Don't like that. So their hand has to have some combo of Wizard's Lightning, Light Up the Stage, that sort of thing. Okay. I like that they put Tormenting Voice in their deck. I don't like that I chart coursed and didn't hit another land. This third Crackling Drake's never going to do anything. The first one's probably going to do something. The second one might do something. And the third one is just like almost 0% to do anything. Yeah, they're having to hard cast Light Up the Stage here. And they hit Fanatical Firebrand Wizard's Lightning. Oh, and they have no lands. Okay, okay. Land, now we'll just go Crackling Drake. Well, you know, if their draw's slow enough, it's possible that the third Crackling Drake does something. If they don't have a Gitu Lava Runner to make this Wizard's Lightning cheaper, I actually kind of like my spot. Okay, there's the Firebrand. They're going to ping me so they can light up the stage again. And they hit the Lava Runner, but do they have the land? They have the Lava Runner, and they didn't draw the land. Huh. Amazing. All right, let's go land. I'm going to play the island first so I can leave up red for shock, because I am going to shock that Lava Runner for sure. The fact that it just turns off their Wizard's Lightning makes it like a no-brainer. Okay, so Wizard's Lightning is just gone. This card's just exiled. Lightning Strike is still on deck here. This can be cast this turn, but it doesn't really do that much. Yeah, Lightning Strike me down to 15 is just not that impressive. And they hit Drill Bit, and wow, they make their deck so much worse after board. Like, I understand why my opponent's siding the way they have, but I'm very happy about it. Like, I would rather face Drill Bits and Lava Coils than my opponent just trying to burn me out. Because now they're just dead. Like, there's no way they can kill me, and there's no way they can stop me from killing them. So they can Lava Coil as many Crackling Drakes as they want. I'm still going to get them. Also, Drill Bits, they probably have like 9 or 10 block sources in their deck, so it's not even... I mean, I guess maybe they have like 12 because they have like 3 or 4 swamps because they're not playing Chain Whirler, but I'm still pretty happy about all this. All right, let's go Opt, Bottom, Land, and Send. Bam. Alrighty, going to game 3. Does that change how I board at all? No, it really does not. Alrighty, welcome to game 3. I'm going to keep this hand. It doesn't have any red sources, but it has an island and an opt, and if I find a red source, mountain ideally, I can start casting, or Sulfur Falls actually, I can cast Shock and whatnot. Phoenix is not a good draw initially, but it actually turns into a good draw if I do draw a red source here, I think. Oh, am I going to get Drill Bitted? Kind of hope so. Let's see what they've got. Lava Runner, sure. And go. All right, opt. Red. Can't keep shock. Island doesn't do it. Okay, there's red. So now I think we just go pass and then upkeep. I guess we'll shock their Lava Runner. I would rather just get damage off the board here, and I'm doing this upkeep so they can't Wizards Lightning me. And then I'm gonna take one. They didn't have Light Up the Stage last turn. They didn't have Drill Bit last turn, so this actually is looking okay. So now I'm gonna play Electromancer Chart of Course. And I assume my Electromancer is dying here. Yeah. And then let's just discard Phoenix here. Just pass the turn. Take one, go to 16. And then now I wish I could just cast a Crackling Drake, but since I can't, I'm just going to play Arclight Phoenix, and I think I can just pass because this forces them to use a removal spell on it, which doesn't matter if they do or don't, you know, like that, whether I attacked or not. And then I would want to keep back that Firebrand. They're flooding out nicely. Nicely. Let's play Crackling Drake here. And then pass, and next turn I'm targeting getting back these two Arclight Phoenixes, which hopefully can race my opponent. They have Lightning Strike plus Shock. Oh man, once they're starting to burn your creatures, you almost always just win. So now I'm going to go Tormenting Voice, discard Island, even though I don't like tap lands all that much. This is going to be great. All right, it's Sheevan Fire, and in response, Sheevan Fire. And the reason I'm doing that is I really want to bring back my two copies of Arclight Phoenix. And if I don't have a target, I don't have a target. So then I get to hit them for six. I've got to race my opponent. They don't have that many creatures in their deck. So a funny play. So all right. So they get to hit two lands off their Light Up the Stage. And then they have a Lava Coil for one of my Phoenixes maybe. Nope. They have a Skewer. Much worse. But actually, given the way my hand is looking, I'm not that close to getting a Phoenix back. This game's actually pretty close. Well, it isn't, it isn't. It isn't in the sense that if my opponent draws a burn spell and kills my Phoenix, like, or it is in the sense that neither of us have anything, but also they're playing the burn deck and I'm at 14 and neither of us have cards in hand. That definitely favors me. Plus I have two Phoenixes in the graveyard if I do draw a string of spells. Oh man, risk factor. That was a great draw for them. Yeah, I'm going to take 4 damage. Yeah, that's one of the cards that can get them into this. Oh, man. Well, I mean, I can float out really badly. I guess that's an option, too. Basically, my deck's full of card draw and powerful spells. Or not full, but it has some. All right, they risk factored again. I'm going to take 4. And they have one card in their deck, man, that draws them extra cards, essentially, or that is really powerful. I guess Light Up the Stage also draws them extra cards. But Risk Factor is just by far their best card. So if they draw Risk Factor and I draw 6 land in a row, then maybe we're in there, or 7. I don't have very many lands left in my deck at this point. Also, they played their land when they have all Risk Factors in their deck. They hit Lava Coil, Wizard's Lightning. So no point in playing a creature this turn. Oh man, this is this is an impressive game to lose, but lose it I shall. I'm almost assuredly dead at this point. All right, now there's an Arclight Phoenix. I guess I have outs, but it just feels really unlikely. Yeah, there goes their Lava Coil. Okay. I mean, that was a different Lava Coil. And Theater of Horrors is just going to kill me based on the activation. And now I draw the negate. Well, it was a pleasure. That'll do it for this video. I'm going to go ahead and concede because at this point, they can shoot me twice a turn and draw a Theater of Horrors. So I'm going to lose that game despite, I think being, I had a Phoenix, or I guess they killed the Phoenix and I was at 14 and we both had essentially no cards in hand. And 4 turns later, here we are. Alrighty, that'll do it for this Drake's video. So it's a good deck. I do think this matchup's bad overall. So, you know, the fact that we ran kind of bad in game 3 doesn't take away from the fact that I think the matchup's in my opponent's favor in general. And we went 2-2. Not the best, but a good start for testing Drakes, which maybe I'll play at the Pro Tour, maybe not.